welcome to Joey and Will at the Movies. I'm your host, Joey Traverso, and I also reviewed movies on Wildcat Weekly last year. Now, normally I do these reviews by myself, but I decided why do that when I could have my good friend and accomplice, Will Ackerman, help me review them. So, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay, well, I come from a background of loving and enjoying film. I grew up with Joey. We've known each other since we were three, and as far back as I can remember, we've loved movies, we love talking about them, seeing them, and all such things. And when Joey approached me with this idea of doing a show like this, I couldn't say no.
So, what we're going to do this show is we'll be reviewing three movies. We'll be reviewing Gone Girl, we'll be reviewing Blue Ruin, which is a Netflix pick of ours, and finally, we will be reviewing Nightcrawler. So, without further ado, let's start with Gone Girl.
Okay, now Gone Girl is a film based off the best-selling novel by Gillian Flynn, who also wrote the screenplay, and it's a film where Ben Affleck plays Nick Dunn, who on his fifth wedding anniversary finds out that his wife, Amy Elliott Dunn, played by Rosamund Pike, has been kidnapped.
Everyone told us and told us marriage is hard work. Not for me and Nick.
As you all know, my wife, Amy Elliott Dunn, disappeared 3 days ago. I had nothing to do with the disappearance of my wife. I have nothing to hide.
Sammy got friends we can talk to?
No, not really.
You don't know if she has friends, you don't know what she does all day, and you don't know your wife's blood type.
Just being a good guy, so everybody can see him being a good guy.
Well, you really don't like him, do you?
All I'm trying to do is be nice to the people who are volunteering to help find Amy.
I will practice believing my husband loves me, but I could be wrong.
Did you see that guy?
I personally think that the performances here are very great. Ben Affleck and Rosamund Pike does an especially great job. I definitely think Pike has the breakout performance here. And there's also Patrick Harris and Tyler Perry, who are very, very great in this movie. This film is also directed by David Fincher, who is one of my favorite working directors right now. Definitely think he does one of his best jobs here. The score by Atticus Ross and I can't think of what his
Trent
name
is.
Trent Reznor. Do a particularly great job. I think this is their best score out of the three that they've done with Fincher. Now, on the downside, I think that the ending for this film goes on a little bit too long. I think that there's a point that they're trying to make, and I think they make the point, but then they just go over that point slightly, just a little bit too far. And I think it could have been a lot quicker. I do think the very ending, the last bit, is very nice, very like poetic justice sort of thing. I just think the whole kind of wrapping up of the story is very dragged on.
Well, I'd have to mostly agree with you. I do think Gone Girl is one of the best movies of the year.
Yeah, of course.
I do think that the screenplay, which I haven't read the novel myself, but it's very well written. There's a lot of character development and everyone is given enough time to shine. All the actors are. I will say that you mentioned that the ending kind of drags on a bit. In fact, I would say it drags on a little bit further even than the ending. There was a certain point where a big plot twist occurs, and while that kind of helps reboot the story a little bit, after about maybe 20 minutes after this plot twist occurs, it just kind of goes downhill from there, in my opinion. Like, some of the energy just starts dying down a little bit.
I don't see that. I think it builds off that energy. Like, the movie starts off very, very, very slow in a sense. When I started watching it, I was like, oh, this is going to be a long movie. But then it just keeps building and building and building and building. And then I think once kind of like the whole plot is wrapped up, and then there's the conclusion where they tie up the endings, like they tie all the loose ends up together, I think that's where it really starts to kind of drag.
I agree it does drag a little bit there, but even a little bit before that, I felt like there wasn't as much happening in the story at this point because the big cards had already been laid on the table. And at this point, it's kind of like, okay, we're going through the motions a little bit. Not a ton new is especially happening with these characters. And I do agree that the original score on a random tangent was very good. But I do think that Atticus Ross and Trent Reznor's best score is still The Social Network. But I do think that the music here fit very well with the overall tone of the film, and I still thought it was a terrific film.
Okay, well, we disagree on some things. Okay, and now on to what we call our top three list. Every episode we do what we call a top. We do have a top three that we kind of tie in together, and with all three of these movies, all three of the movies that we are reviewing here are somewhat dark and slightly disturbing in some aspects. And so with our top three list this week, we went with top three scenes from movies that like kind of like disturbed us and that scarred us for life in particular. My number three is the talking tree scene from Wizard of Oz, the talking apple trees that throw apples at Dorothy.
Ouch!
What do you think you're doing?
We've been walking a long ways and I was hungry and... Did you say something?
She was hungry! Well, how would you like to have someone come along and pick something off of you?
Oh, dear. I keep forgetting I'm not in Kansas.
Come along, Dorothy. You don't want any of those apples.
Are you hitting my apples on what they ought to be?
Oh, no. It's just that she doesn't like little green worms.
Oh, you...
I'll show you how to get apples.
Now, I just recently viewed this movie again, and it's very... It's not as disturbing, but it still is kind of a little freaky because everything else in the movie that's like not exactly human but is has a human-looking face, but these trees don't, and it's very kind of freaky. When I was a little kid, this gave me nightmares, okay? That's where I'm coming from with this.
Okay, well, I'll do my number three, which is actually a real disturbing scene. My number three is the dinner scene from the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. And when they talk in the beginning of the movie about something mad and macabre, this is the true definition of it. Leatherface and the family sitting with the victim and basically terrorizing her as much as the audience. This is one of the most effective horror movie scenes of all time because of just how disturbing and how kind of, there's almost like a kind of a dark comedy element that makes it even a little more terrifying.
Yeah, that's the hit over the head one, right?
Yeah. Exactly. But yeah, definitely one of the most scarring film scenes that I've ever seen, especially from a horror film, and that's saying quite a bit because there are quite a few disturbing horror film scenes.
Very true.
Very true. So our next movie is Blue Ruin, the Netflix pick. Would you like to talk a little bit about that?
Okay, yes. Every week we're going to recommend a Netflix movie. This week we thought instead of doing that we would review a Netflix movie for you that we think we might be off your radar, but you should definitely check out. Now, Blue Ruin is a low budget thriller from Jeremy Saulnier, who also wrote and directed, and he did the cinematography for the movie. It stars Macon Blair in the main role as a homeless person, sort of adolescence in a blue ruin, the wrecked car of the title, and something from his past comes up that causes him to go and get revenge.
I know he's out, if that's why you're here.
I'd forgive you if you were crazy, but you're not. You're weak.
I'll shed no tears.
I'll shed no
tears. God damn!
You missed from 2 yards? I'm switching you to buckshot.
This is ugly, man.
Yeah. Hello. It's me. By my count, that's two of yours and two of mine. I don't know how this ends, but I'd like it to.
Now, I think the cinematography here especially deserves a very good note because it's breathtakingly beautiful and it looks like a picture. It honestly was, I was taken away by the cinematography here. Especially because the most of the movie is very silent. In fact, there's not a lot of, there is talking here, but a lot of the movie is very much, very quiet in a sense. But I think that it's just, it's beautiful. It's like a dark, twisted fairy tale in a sense. I do think Blair in the title role is incredibly effective. I think he hits all these sorts of deep notes without saying a lot, which I think is really hard acting to do, maybe even the hardest. I think it's really good. It, definitely the style of this film and the performance, and especially with Solner's direction, it definitely reminded me of like Nicholas Winding Refn, who did Drive and Only God Forgives, in that there isn't a lot of talking. Same, a lot of the actors, they go through their arcs through like just through their facial expressions, through their eyes. And it's very, very hard to do, and I've seen other directors try and do it, and it's not very effective. I think this movie does it very effectively. Now again, I like the wrap-up of the film, but the climax seems kind of underwhelming in a sense, but I do think that is what Solner is going for. I just think it was slightly underwhelming than what the film had been building up. But overall, it's a very tense, exciting, violent, visceral film that has a great song drop in, No Regrets by Little Willie John.
Well, I gotta say, as I was watching this movie, I was kind of reminded a little bit of some of the darker material from the Coen brothers.
I did not get that comparison.
I just thought No Country for Old Men, because there were kind of elements of kind of dark comedy mixed within a little bit of like brutality. And I gotta say, like, the whole movie, I was thinking of how bland it is compared to the Coen brothers. Now, this is not a bad movie by any stretch. I do think, like you said, the cinematography is stunning, and I think all the performers do an excellent job, but I just don't think the script is interesting at all. I think all these characters are very bland, and they're kind of intentionally bland, but it's to the point where you don't really care about what's going on screen. In my personal experience, I found it to be boring the whole way through. There were some memorable moments and memorable scenes, but I really didn't find there was enough relevant character development to justify a whole story.
I thought there was character, like development is in that main character, definitely. I mean, like he definitely goes through an arc from like, he's very adolescent, very trapped, and like, I mean, I definitely think the film gets its point home and whatever. I think the actors do well. I do think some characters are kind of bland, but not really. No, not all of them.
They're all bland.
Name one that's bland.
All of them.
That's not one.
More than one. Okay. And that's all you need to know about this
movie. They're not bland. It's a very good movie. I think you should check out. It's on Netflix if you have Netflix. It's on Netflix streaming. Netflix streaming, by the way.
That's about all it's worth. I'd say watch it on Netflix, but if you had to pay to watch it, then absolutely
no.
Don't.
I would. You I can would do better. I would pay for it. I definitely expect to. Okay.
Well, you.
Now on to our top two. Our top two for most scarring movie scenes. My number two is kind of a cheat here. Originally it was. It's from the same movie. It's from The Shining. My top two is the trailer for The Shining, which is the elevator scene, it's from the elevator scene, and it's where the elevator opens up and the blood pours out. I didn't see The Shining for the longest time, but I saw this trailer on like iTunes or whatever, because I wanted to see this movie because I know it's a very famous movie, and I've seen the Come Play With Us Danny scene, which was my original number two, but I watched the trailer again just this past weekend, and it just, the music is so disturbing. It's so very, very weird, and it just kind of freaks me out very much.
Now The Shining is one of your favorite movies of all time.
I guess
the movie is just as effective as the trailer.
Scariest movie ever made.
You know, I haven't seen the trailer in a while, but I remember that sticking with me even before I saw the movie, just as with you. So I can see why that's on here. My number two is kind of similar to his number three in that it's not necessarily the most terrifying scene in the world. In fact, it's not even scary at all. But as a child, it scared me a lot. So my number two is the crocodile scene from Peter Pan. And viewers, you may be wondering, what are you talking about? Why is this scarring at all? And to be honest, I cannot adequately answer that question.
please, don't let him get me, Speed.
Here now, shame on you, upsetting the poor captain. There'll be no handouts today. See now, see. Go on, off it. Off with your ass. Go away.
Nothing is really particularly scary about the crocodile Peter Pan scene. It's just that as a kid, I had nightmares about it, so I was inclined to put it.
To clarify, it's the Walt Disney one, right?
It's the Walt Disney Peter Pan, and the crocodile scene scared me as a kid. And not even when I was awake. I just went to sleep, and I had nightmares about it. I don't even know why. But it was one of the most terrifying. Yeah, the clock and, you know, him running away on water and, yeah. Okay. So I guess we'll move on to our next film and our final film, which is Nightcrawler, a film starring Jake Gyllenhaal as what you would call a nightcrawler. He investigates crimes in L.A. that occurred during the late hours of the night or early hours of the morning. And he's basically, what would you call an investigative journalist?
Yeah.
Essentially.
I don't think he's so much of a journalist. I think he captures when you see local news and you see crime as a car accident and you see like the wreckage or whatever, like say there's a shooting and you see that what's called B-roll, and you see like the wreckage or bodies and stuff like that. That's basically what he captures. He sometimes gets interviews, maybe. But
he mainly just does the actual footage of the scene that occurs.
Yeah.
And so eventually his career starts to build up and he starts getting mixed in with some of these crimes. He withholds information from the police and he does this all for the purpose of the story.
The name of my company is Video Production News, a professional news gathering service. That's how it should be read and that's how it should be said. I also want to go to the next rung and meet your team and the station manager and the director and the anchors and start developing my own personal relationships. I'd like to start meeting them this morning. You'll take me around, you'll introduce me as the owner and president of Video Production News and remind them of some of my many other stories. I'm not done. I also want to stop our discussion over prices. This will save time. So when I say that a particular number is my lowest price, that's my lowest price. And you can be assured that I arrived at whatever that number is very carefully. Now, when I say that I want these things, I mean that I want them, and I don't want to have to ask again.
Now, Jake Gyllenhaal, it would be a shame if he wasn't nominated for an Academy Award this year because his performance is absolutely riveting. You don't see Jake Gyllenhaal, you see Lou Bloom, and it is one of the most captivating performances of the year. But the real star of Nightcrawler is Dan Gilroy, who wrote and directed the film, and he directs all the scenes with such careful intensity. He knows how to direct actors, and he knows how to direct action scenes. In fact, Nightcrawler has one of the best car chases I've seen in a movie in the past several years. In addition, the script constantly throws in new stuff at you, both developing Gyllenhaal's character and other characters. The tensity keeps building up throughout the entire movie and never lets up until it's over. It also comes to a satisfying, if slightly brief and rushed, conclusion. But overall, Nightcrawler is easily one of the year's best films, thanks to a smart script and a memorable performance by Jake Gyllenhaal.
Now, I have to agree on most of those points. I do think that all across the board, I do think Jake Gyllenhaal is definitely kind of like the outgoing great performance here. You definitely lose him. I haven't seen a lot of Jake Gyllenhaal. I haven't seen Donnie.
You especially haven't seen him like in something like this for a very long
time. I personally have not seen Donnie Darko, where he does play a psychopath. And I know some people think, not psychopath, sociopath, I believe. Sociopath is the correct term. But I definitely think that you don't see him here. You see this character. He's very good in that. I think his partner, who I can't think of the actor's name, but that is definitely the second best performance in the film.
He's definitely like the most human of the characters. Oh, he definitely has the most morals.
Yeah,
in the story,
he's absolutely. I would say he's the only likable character in this movie. Like he's the only character you can relate to in us.
Yeah.
You kind of root for Gyllenhaal, but he's not a very good person. I definitely think this is a great directorial debut from Dan Gilroy. It's amazing. The cinematography, who is Paul Thomas Anderson's usual cinematographer, is great. He does amazing work here. This film has one of the greatest car chases I've seen since.
Since Drive.
I would definitely say those two. But on the ending, I think the ending is very rushed. I did not like the ending.
You see, I kind of disagree there. I mean,
you disagree with me all the time.
Agree to disagree, but I would just say it does. it maybe could have extended it out a little bit longer, but at the same time, it concluded the way it needed to. It wrapped up the story, and I feel like all the character points.
I would say the very last thing that happens is what is the right thing that happens. Yeah. But the film sets up this kind of third act, and it's not in a sense that Gilroy is pulling the rug out from under you, being like, "Oh, here's your expectations. Now we're not." It's kind of the thing is this. While watching this film, I was reminded of There Will Be Blood in a sense, in some ways, which also is a very kind of like conclusion and like a very just brief ending.
Right, and that's what it was going for.
In that film, though, the story has ended. There is nothing more to be there. There is stuff that is set up in Nightcrawler that doesn't deliver on it.
Oh, there was these different. There's the
I definitely see that, and I definitely when I sat there at the end, I'm like, I sat there going, that's it. I mean, I loved it up until that point.
I mean, I could definitely see like why it's a little brief, but I never felt unsatisfied as the credits rolled.
No, I felt satisfied up until that point. That's definitely a low point to the film.
Well,
I think.
We agree to disagree.
You can agree to disagree. Okay.
Well, now we're gonna move on to our number one top three pick of most scarring movie scenes, and my personal number one is the chase scene with Laurie Strode from the original Halloween. Anyone who has seen the original Halloween will know just how effectively it uses music and performances to absolutely terrorize the audience. And this scene in particular is one of the prime examples of that. Now, as Laurie Strode runs across the street and knocks on the door for Tommy and Michael Myers approaches the house, the music builds up to an absolute terrifying level, making for one of the most terrifying horror movie scenes of all time. When I watched this film for the first time, I kept thinking of this scene and it repeated in my head for weeks and weeks, and I wasn't able to sleep well. And so if you want to look for a good horror movie scene and one that will probably scar you for quite a while, then definitely check out Halloween, the chase scene with Laurie Strode.
Okay, now mine could be scary. It's still watching it again. It is kind of very disturbing and very weird. It's the musical number Pink Elephants on Parade from Walt Disney's Dumbo. This is the sequence in which Dumbo and his mouse friend get drunk.
Unusual view. I can stand the sight of worms and look at microscopic germs, but Technicolor pachyderms is really too much for me.
I am not the type to faint when things are odd or things are quaint, but seeing things you know that ain't can certainly give you an awful fright. What a sight!
Chase them away! Chase them away! I'm afraid, need your eight big elephants on parade.
And they hallucinate pink elephants on parade. It's a very chippy sequence. Walt Disney was he was working with Salvador Dali at the time that they made this movie. So that's where some people see the influence. It's a very freaky scene. And in particular, I'm thinking of the part where there's an elephant made up of just these elephant heads that are different colors walking, and that freaked me out when I saw it as a kid. And I wasn't able to watch the movie for a very long time. Watching it again, it is a very great movie. And that's your
number one. Two scenes that aren't scarring. Well, anyways, that's it for this edition of At the Movies with Joey and Will. Thank you for watching, and tune in next time for our review of Interstellar and The Hunger Games: Mockingjay Part 1.
And Birdman. Birdman. And yes, and that. And then we haven't decided on the top three yet, but we will figure that out yet. And yeah.
Peace out.